Corner Talk. We're back, and today we have a special guest, Tai Emery, who is one of my favorite people I haven't met, and she will be fighting at BKFC Thailand September 3rd against a pro fighting debut, by the way, against Rungarun Kunchai. Am I saying that correct?
Correct.
Yes. So, how is the feeling today, like this fight week? How is it different than any other week that you've been training?
Well, right now I'm still in a sweatsuit. So I fly out tomorrow morning, which is where I'll also continue with the cutting process down at Pom Gym in BKK. But yeah, so right now I'm sitting in a sweatsuit. I have to go to bed at a certain weight. I guess what's the difference is I've got Galupi Nutrition, which I've been working with him over the last few years. I met him when I was at the UFCPI and there was the Tough 28. Mm-hmm. I was working in Claudia Gadelia's camp. So I met Galupi 3 years ago. But I think for the difference, obviously, in Muay Thai, sometimes there's not really a weigh-in. So just making sure that I'm dialing in correctly, and then, you know, the weight cut can make you or break you. So I think that's the difference for, yeah, right now, as I sit in a sweatsuit. that's probably the main difference. There's a lot more interviews happening, which are good because I feel like it allows you to kind of walk the story. And I've been able to kind of appreciate some of the questions asked, or just the mind frame that it puts me into as well. I feel a lot more appreciative. But knowing that it's like the pro debut, like this is the big leagues, man, there's just so many memories and a million goosebumps that continue to happen because, yeah, collectively, this is decisions and life choices and luck and changing the cards that were dealt to you. Like, there's just so many things that have brought to this week. So, yeah, this week is definitely different to every other fight or even every single football game that I've ever played. Like, it's mindset, it's being happy, it's crying, it's sweating. It's such it's an emotional roller coaster, but also just like understanding that I still feel so fucking strong and my mind feels even stronger. And I think that's the most exciting part, you know. Happy fighter is a scary fighter. A strong mind is, you know, that's the main chess move.
Yeah, I was a fighter's telling me the most important thing is having fun. A lot of people like lose that sense of having fun, and especially for a pro debut, it's very difficult to maintain, I guess, the having fun aspect. But if you're feeling this already in fight week, like that's already a good sign.
Like, yeah, I'm a serious person, super down to earth, but I love to laugh, mate. Like, I love to laugh. I love to have fun. Even in sparring, like some people can be so serious and I'm that person who's like, woo! Like, I'm having a good time or I'm dancing and people are like, Ty, take this serious. And I'm like, bro, play state is actually better for learning and creativity if you've read some books, but you know, that's a different avenue.
Yeah, I mean, the weight cutting can definitely affect your mood a lot. Like, that's why a lot of the time I do interview fighters on the first day of fight week, which is different, and not like near the end when they're still cutting weight, but it's good to see you in good spirits.
Thank you.
So how did you actually end up in Thailand? Because your story is all over the place. You've lived all over the place, and now you seem to have settled, like, at least for how long? How long have you been here?
I've been here nearly 3 years. So 2019. Yeah, I've been here a minute.
And it wasn't the plan to like stick around, right?
I was only meant to be here for a short time, working on a recovery program. I'm a registered yoga teacher. So I was working my own invented program. And then I was to fly to Bali to guest speak at a meditation retreat that I was working in as well. So we went from that total aspect to then COVID happening. And for fighting, I did always want to get out to Thailand. When I meet fighters, every single one of them have a small story from their time in Thailand, when like talking to them about their journey or where they felt the most growth. So I always wanted to get out here. But I never would have thought, and nobody ever would have thought, that something like COVID would happen. And it was like a movie for me. Like, I'm standing at the airport and things are just going, wah, wah, wah. And I just thought, this this is literally crazy. Like, what is going on? Okay, so I'm about to miss out on a very big payday, which was going to pay for my visa to re-enter into America, because I had been living there for 5 or 6 years. I was playing pro football with the LFL. I was a defense all-star player. And then Misha Tate helped me to transition into fighting. So that was kind of that small story. But yeah, so I end up getting stuck out here. COVID happens. I think I had like $120 for X amount of period of time. Yes. And we're in a third world country. So I went back to this Muay Thai gym that's literally a hole in the wall, just like a shed with concrete floor, two basic shed rooms, an outdoor kitchen, a Muay Thai like ring inside the, you know, underneath the shed.
Yeah.
I went back to there because that's where I'd been doing some training. And I said, you know, like, this is what's happening. We all have no idea what's going happening in the future. And, you know, I need help, because that's the truth. I needed help. And so that's where I lived. I lived on a mattress on the concrete floor for maybe 8 months and just learned how to punch and kick and change my life.
That's
really
sink or swim.
Changed my life.
It's crazy because so it wasn't even your intention to fight. But then you just
I really wanted to learn the fighting aspect just because I am Maori, and I, you know, I guess slowly that's kind of where I fell. When I was a linebacker, I did a lot of boxing and wrestling because I felt that that helped me with line, being on the line and being able to tackle girls that were much larger than myself. I come from a rugby background, so I can form tackle. I played rugby league, rugby union, touch football, you name it, I've played it. And so I did a lot of wrestling stuff just so I could understand how to use someone's weight and flip them onto the ground even better, you know. So I kind of have already been training that for a few years, but never in my mind did I think that I would want to fight. I think that it scared me. You know, as most people are. It's not something that you all of a sudden get punched in the face and I'm kind of laughing and feeling like okay about it. I think that's a scary moment, you know, to realize you're like, am I sick?
Like crazy? Yeah.
Am I crazy? Well, I know that I am, but I'm the good crazy, as we all say.
I say for a lot of people, like when they get punched in the face the first time, that's when they like get over it. And then they, it's like the realization that you really want to do this, you know?
Yeah.
I go to the drilling, that should be over in a second, I hope. Do you hear it?
So that's my old job. I was an electrician and a thermographer. So they're just hammer drilling. They're probably doing like saddles and stuff.
Yeah, now it's not even electricity. It's like sewage, because yesterday I could smell it. It's like they know my schedule. Sure. They actually, like, last time they drilled was the same day I had a podcast again. So, yeah. Anyway. But that is pretty crazy. So you went in there, you're like, okay, just I'm going to do Muay Thai, and then you fell in love with combat sports, because I was wondering, what is your background in combat sports? Like, what... did you used to watch it? Is there any specific ones that you were like a big fan of? Or
I watched like a little bit when I was up in Cairns with my friends that were up there. I remember watching my first UFC and just wrestling one of my mates and just being naturally good.
Yeah.
Like just enjoying it too. But nothing ever really clicked. Like it didn't really click back then. Even back then, I was still an electrician. I never would have thought that I was going to, you know, move on to become an all-star defense player over in America, you know.
Like, take it. You were like, you were making good money then too, like with that job. And
of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Really good money. But money doesn't fill everything. And I used to think that it did. And I'm someone that always like answers the call of my soul and whatever pull that is or whatever dream that's going on in my head, I follow that. And I've had the most amazing life, and I came from absolute nothing. So I really love that I've always had that sort of strength to not listen to people around me and go after that feeling of magnetism, as cliche as it sounds. Even walking into this first BKFC fight, this is a dream. And growing up, I wanted to be a mutant. I really read a lot of comic books, and in some sort of way, I think those dreams that we, you know, imagine as a kid, somehow they're still like deeply rooted inside our brain. And as long as we're like answering anything that our own passion calls, we can end up there in a sick, twisted way that the universe delivers, you know?
Yeah. It's like the dream you didn't know you had, sort of.
Yes.
It just, you discover those dreams again as you go in life.
Yeah.
And it really resonates with me because during COVID as well, like I realized I was doing just a lot of corporate work, a lot of this video stuff that pays very well, you know, it fills the pockets, but at some point, like it becomes very soulless. And I think like, what are my skills? Like, I have this production skills and stuff. Why don't I take it to a domain that I'm enjoying, like the combat sports department? So I think it's good timing I'm talking to you because maybe you can give me some advice. I am actually making a leap. I live in Amsterdam. And on the 7th of September, like last month, I had a couple of signs to just book a ticket, no return to California, you know, be in California and Vegas, use my network, sink or swim again, you know, chase that. Like, what are some advice that you have for a move like that?
Do it.
That's it.
No, just do it.
It feels
Don't
right.
Think, yeah, go with what feels right. But guess what? It doesn't feel right. And nothing feels right ever. But when you're going to sleep and when you wake up in the morning, even if it's through tears, there's something that's still making you want to go there, making you want to enter that gym, making you want to go and do another podcast or find it some, you know, new athletes to interview. Mm-hmm. When you have that drive, it doesn't matter whether you're sitting on a cardboard box or means you might have to miss a few meals or for some reason you're all of a sudden sitting there and you're at a Rolling Stones event. There's all these crazy signs that you just have to keep doing it. And as long as that's where the drive is, like that internal drive, you just have to keep going with it. Mm-hmm. Whether you think it's right or wrong, you just have to keep going. Never quit.
That's
true.
It's like, you don't want to live with a regret.
It's not simple, but it is. What was that? Sorry,
I didn't mean to cut you off. There was a bit of a delay, I think. No, it's like, it feels like it's one of those things where if I don't do it now, I think I'm going to look back and regret it. And it's
of course,
never
do you want to do that?
I don't. See, that's the thing. And I just turned 30. So I'm like, I think this is a good year, good age to like to make those big moves, you know?
Hey, and I'm 35.
Yeah.
And I'm so sick of people being as if like we've been brainwashed to believe that we're dead at 30. We're literally brainwashed to believe that we are dead, and it's not. This is where we're like everything's aligning for us. We've just spent, you know, 10 years developing ourselves and working all these small jobs to develop even more skills that we didn't realize we even had. 30s is for applying that and just chasing everything. Why are we stuck in such a rat race? And of course, like there's different goals for different people, and that's not to say that them going after a corporate job. Hey, guess what? I think it's hot as shit when I'm talking to someone and they're like in the high up in the corporate world. You're like, wow, that's dedication. That's you're using all of your skills because you can't get to that level without having any of those skills naturally, but having the discipline to act upon it. And that's the same for people who are, you know, doing your podcast, someone who's an athlete. It's understanding and where you have those skill sets and then going for it, you know?
Yeah. It's well, yeah. Like I would say, like everyone has several skills, and also I don't think someone. Well, you know this more than anyone because you cannot. You shouldn't define yourself, I think, by the one job you do or the thing. Like I talk to a lot of fighters. They're like, I'm a fighter, and they just define themselves as a fighter. And I'm like, okay, after your career, what are you gonna do? They got lost, you know. So it's like I see myself as like you see yourself as a brand, in a way. And you have all these different skills and you have to try to explore every single one of them. Nobody has one skill. So,
see, I've had a few hats. I've gone from being a model, then an electrical contractor, and then a thermographer, and then a football player, and now a fighter. And even in between that, I was a babysitter, a dog sitter, house cleaner, a house designer. I've done all these small odd jobs that, you know, just small odd jobs that helped. And then these major careers that I've also jumped into as well. Did I ever think that it would lead to now? Like things that I was doing as an electrical contractor, whether it be saving money, invoicing, understanding business or understanding sponsors or understanding just how to run a project. Right now, I'm using all of those same skills as a fighter. It's just that I'm the project. Like this is my work, you know. It's crazy, all those things. Yeah, we're just meant to develop who we are and then continue to like go through that. That's what's being human. I think that's exciting.
Yes.
I'm excited for you.
Well, thank you. Though I'm excited too. For the first time, I'm nervous going somewhere, you know, but I know I'm just going to be, yes, but nerves keep me sharp. Nerves will make me go out there, meet people, and that's all that's about, you know. And I tell fighters all the time, if you have access to an industry, right? It's not like you, when you're a fighter, all you do is just fight and train. Like, take notice of how management works, how the production side of things work, and how all that works. Because that is like actually PhD type stuff that, you know, people who just have theoretical knowledge and studies and stuff dream of, that kind of experience. So
exactly,
you're more advantaged
experience
than anyone.
Trumps everything. Experience trumps everything.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly. And I do feel younger now than I did at 25, let's say. It's weird.
Yeah, so do I.
Right? Well, you're doing things like 25-year-old, and I'm sure your body, your fitness is like that fitness of a 25-year-old or younger. So, you know.
That it is.
Age is a man-made concept, you know. Your body doesn't care about man-made concepts, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't.
So it's crazy. So you're in Thailand. You've been in Thailand for 3 years. And you were kind of forced to stay there in a way, and then you fell in love with it, it seems like. What are some of the biggest culture shocks that you've experienced? Some crazy stories.
Culture shocks that some Thais are either Buddhist or some are Muslim. The Muslim, I'm learning about the separation of dogs. And, you know, we as an Australian, a dog is either a tool, a weapon, you know, as a weapon or a gatekeeper or a security guard, or it's man's best friend. It's your family member. So to go from having where that, and then where people would kick a dog, try to kill a dog. You can't have a dog anywhere near a kitchen, near people, even touch a dog. I think that was a huge culture shock. Also, I'm Australian and Maori. And so I grew up, you know, around the beach. So having to cover up as well, and no, for everyone, they're like, that's so simple. But no, it isn't as simple if that's not how you grew up. And if I grew up in swimsuits, then having to cover up, like that's been another thing, is just learning to respect people's, I guess, not just boundaries, but just their beliefs. And if that's something that's provokes them and they've been taught that it does, I think I just need to have more respect in that way. Also, I think their love of food. I love that in Thailand, they always sit and eat. Like, imagine that, a white person coming to your family going, hey, I've got no money or anything, and you just need to help me. But lucky for me, they did know me. And of course, they were willing to help. But to see someone from a third world country where we would all sit on the floor and, you know, there'd be other people who'd come around on the street. There was always at least three other people eating together at one time. So they're just so giving. That's so giving. Like, nobody goes without food. Someone can always have somewhere to sleep. I think that's amazing. And I think that's obviously in all cultures, but to see that in a third world, it really shows you like money isn't happiness, and there's so much more.
Yeah, it's like they have certain values that they invest their, they choose to invest their, like, even though they have less money, they choose to invest it in things that they find important, which is the community. And because I grew up in Jordan, which is, I guess it's semi-third world, you can say. It's Middle East. I'm half Jordanian. And over there, it is very much the same. It's like the community feeling is so big because they know that back in the day they had to survive together in groups, because as an individual,
exactly,
you can't really survive. Yeah.
Yeah, you can't.
And it just like seeps into the culture. And I hope they stop drilling. But I mean, it's going to be fine. How did that change your approach? Like the whole community feel and the things you've learned, like how did that sort of change your outlook on life?
I come from like a broken family. So I think I have always valued my friends. I've always valued being in a family home. I love being around other people at Christmas, you know, getting to watch these things that I guess I just didn't even, know that existed. I loved being able to feel like you're a part of the tribe. I loved that I could become a part of that tribe and learn on a deeper scale, whether it be learning to speak basic Thai from a three-year-old or them truly wanting me to understand the energy and the spirit of Muay Thai and being able to be a part of that culture and not be excluded. I love that they see, I love to learn and I really love to feel. So even doing a Wu Krai dance before a Muay Thai, I loved getting to be taught how to even do that. Like, imagine that hundreds of years ago, there's no way you're going to go into a Muay Thai fight and as a white man be allowed to do this. So for me, I'm Maori as well. So I feel a lot. I feel energy so much. And I'm sure every fighter says the same thing. So to feel like I got to completely become immersed in the culture and learning Thai and being around no English speakers for months and months on end, it blew my mind. It still breaks my mind. It still breaks my soul, and rebuilds it like every single day.
And that's a very recent thing where, centuries of Thai culture and, well, I don't know how long it's been, like Muay Thai culture, where like now they're starting to accept and include like all these different people from other parts of the world. And then I guess for your Maori heritage, it means a lot because it's like a warrior sort of background,
exactly.
You know? Yeah. It's like different warriors from different, if you look centuries ago, it's like different warriors and tribes getting together. And
I can
see how that like fuels your fire.
It does. Sure. Yeah, it does.
Speaking of fueling your fire. So how did BKFC approach you and what were your thoughts? Why did you decide to do this? Because it's the most brutal form.
Okay, I feel like I was talking with one of my mates and he said, right, like, where are you going to go with this? He was one of my mouth guard sponsors, passed away of COVID. So I feel even more deeply for this. But I remember him being like, where's your next goals? Like, where are we wanting to go? And I said, I'm in love and just fascinated by BKFC. And I said, I'd love to be able to fight for them. I feel I wouldn't have to hide any part of myself. I feel I could just be even more enabled to be my own personality. To be honest, they called me. Like, they called me up. I remember picking up the phone and I went, fuck off, you know, just thinking this was an absolute joke. Hung up, and I remember they continued to call, send me messages until they got David Feldman to send me a message, you know, in a group message going, hey, Ty's feeling like this is really unsurreal. So we're trying to make this a little bit more real for her. And he's like, yeah, welcome. You know, welcome. We'd love to have you. And I just remember thinking, oh my gosh. Oh, well, let's put our little friendly voice on. Hey guys, that's so nice.
I was just kidding. I was joking.
Hell no. I literally said to them, I said, look, guys, if yous are the big brothers that I need for you to walk my ass into the playground so that I get to play, I said, let's fucking go. If you can take me to the playground, let's go. Let's see what we can do. From there, here we are.
If you watch that movie, Yes Man, it's like I don't know, it could be 10 years old, Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey?
Yeah. Yeah.
I know the one, but I have not seen that in such a long time.
There's actually an Aussie actor in it, I remember. But that's what your life is feeling like. It's like, you know what, I'm just going to start saying yes to everything, you know? And that's basically what it is. But so what part of the reason you're very interested in BKFC is because I understand it. It's their unfiltered approach as well, where everybody is allowed to be themselves, say whatever they want, you know?
Yeah. Because I feel that maybe in the others, it's in their personality. A lot of the fighters that I meet that are signed with UFC or signed with ONE, they do have a more like martial art, you know, that traditional, like, yes. And just so kind and quiet and hey, that's cool. They've found where their niche is and they've found where, you know, they're going to prosper. But what about the rest of us who have crazy personalities? Do you think that's going to last long when you're in somewhere where, man, I'm pretty sure I've said more than 5 swear words already, you know, like I forget that I'm still a representation for either sponsors and my work. Like, I am a representation of BKFC, but I feel that sometimes we're getting a little lost. Like, there's kids and people out there who need to be inspired by people like us too, because they resonate and feel that, you know, just like when you read a comic book, there is a mutant that can resonate with every single person out there. You can find characters where you just feel, man, even those superpowers, I feel like they would be mine, or I feel like, oh, yes, you know, their troubles were like mine. And that's the same for each fighter. So you need different characters to inspire something different and inspire different change. So I feel like BKFC is allowing maybe the villain looking people to have a shot and to have a chance, and maybe came from that rougher background. Hey, guess what? Every single fighter had something happen. Everyone's got a sad story. Guess what? Work harder. Nobody gives a shit. And that's the truth. And that's fucking life. And yeah, I just feel like BKFC is just allowing people to not be muted, to not be censored, to be a bit more real and raw. If anything, they're going to enable us and be those kids who are like laughed at us in class and just made us want to do more, you know, like, let's put on a show. But to each their own.
Yeah, they put up the, did you see like last week they had the guy who was telling his opponent, like, after I beat you, I'm gonna fuck your dog, like that, you know? I'm like, whoa, that's heavy. But they put it out, like, they put the clip out there, like, so that's, you know, they're enabling it. So, you know, not that I encourage that, but it says something. And this is what I like about interviewing fighters. I haven't, like, interviewed a lot of artists, but a lot of artists are a lot more reserved and a lot more brand aware, you know, that stuff. Because
of course,
fighting has a different type of sponsors because it's a raw thing. Like, people are destroying each other. So,
you can't hide your personality when you fight. Just like if you're a dancer, yeah, they can show you, you know, if you're in the ballet, you need to conform and be a certain thing. But I'm sure there's a lot of, like, people who want to just dance their own dance. And in fighting, you can look at someone, and I remember laughing just being able to see people's true personalities, because you can't hide that. That's the most rawest thing there is. It's, you're playing music out there.
Yeah, I have an experience in that. We did the amateur MMA tournament here. I like did some content. I was shadowing actually Team Australia. Great people, instantly bonded, you know, because Aussies are cool. And at this tournament, you know, it's like some people fight like twice a day, you run over a whole weekend, and you really get to see a side of them that, and the reason you bond so quickly with fighters is because you get to see a side of them that their best friends and their family doesn't even see. Like, they don't see the breakdown after a fight, or you travel the whole world to lose in 1 minute and the emotion that comes with that. And then the emotion of winning a tournament, like some of them won, and then everything, the whole history of the struggles they've been through to get there, and the wanting to quit so many times, this all falls on them and they just break down, and it's a side their family doesn't even see. They probably hide that from their, you know, from their closest friends or family. And that's why I think strong bonds are formed.
It's brave for anyone, whether you're an artist or a fighter, whether you're putting your painting out there, your music, your poetry, just going and fighting, your designed clothing. You're showing your passion, you're showing your heart, but you're also putting it out there to be loved and hated on. And that's a scary thing too, because you love what you do so much, but that's the reality. The reality is I could be doing all this and I'm feeling pumped and prime and I go out there and get fucking KO'd, you know, that could be a reality. And I think everybody accepts that before even going in. Like, I have accepted in every moment, in, I want to win so bad, I will fucking die in there, you know, like, that's how bad I want it. I am willing to go in there and potentially die just to be myself.
If you at least, take the worst case scenario, you know, as a base.
Of course.
Yeah, then
still a percentage.
Yeah, you're prepared for that. So what is, like, so I'm going to ask, what's your mental preparation like, you know? Because how do you even mentally prepare for, like, bare knuckle fighting?
I think just accepting that I have controlled aggression, understand and control all of the emotions of, I guess, pain and understand how strong I am and know that I'm strong and not have to go out there using a pain set mindset. And just, yeah, understanding how strong and how deep my mind is, and just having full faith in my own abilities, and I guess stop being blinded to yourself as well. You know, For me, I know I want to have fun. That's in my personality. But I'm also so super serious. So this isn't something to just laugh about, but to be able to go in there and just, yeah, be yourself, stay strong, and have a good time. Like, you know, when people are just so on their shit that everything they do, you're just having the best time. You're laughing so much.
Yeah.
You're taking a million, like, have a look at every girl, and the selfie is universal, people. So when a girl's feeling herself, she's in a bomb outfit, she is just shining. She's taking selfies, she's feeling good. And that's what Fight Week is about, is just getting into that state of flow where nothing can touch you. Everything is just falling off, even bad things. You understand. I had this thing the other day. It was like, it doesn't matter whether I do want to do something or don't want to do something. If you have to do it, you just get up and go. And that's some things that I just keep thinking when I feel that I'm starting to get tired, I realize I'm like, there is no time for tired. We have to do this. And that's the same mindset I used to have when it hit 10 p.m. and I'm digging a trench for Queensland Rail and we're pulling in new sub mains, like, and it's pissing down with rain. And I remember laughing and just having this deepest laugh, and all the boys would be like, what are you laughing at? And I'm like, one day we'll miss this, boys, you know. And I've said the same line when I was in football, and they made us wake up at 3 a.m. carrying, like, our teammates on our shoulders and people crying. And I remember having this same deep belly laugh and just being like, one day we'll miss this, ladies, you know, like, because we will. You'll miss those moments. So,
but do you,
I
though?
Don't know. I really, yeah, for sure. Okay. Like, so when I start being tired, I just go, you know, there's no time for tired. And all of a sudden it just disappears and I get the job done and we go.
Yeah, so but I had this yesterday, like, it's like important to find that, like, ability to tap into that element, or to tap into that side of yourself where, like, you know what things you have to do to sort of get yourself in that zone. Like, for me, it was like the right playlist. Like, you know, yesterday also, like, overslept, was pissed, I'm so busy, in a week I'm traveling across the world, and I just, like, went to training, put on the right playlist, put on the right music. I was untouchable. I had great training, started working my orthodox, looked great. And then I was, like, vibing. I find myself in the grocery store, like, dancing, like, or, like, you know, moving around. And then I was like, I'm untouchable. I'm going to do this. Everything's going to be fine.
Yes. And it will be, though.
It will.
Trust me, it will be.
Man, yeah, I got Ashley looking out for me there. So it's that's going to be the main contact, I think.
Sure.
I trust it. And how about, like, physically, like, adapting your training? Because now you've trained Muay Thai, and then BKFC approached you. I'm sure you've been working boxing mostly, but how do you adapt your training?
Before that, I'd actually put a focus on my wrestling and my jiu-jitsu. Okay. So here I get signed by BKFC, useless. And I was like, like, let's get back to the boxing. But I really love it, because BKFC is a completely different sport. And I'm coming from football, I'm coming from Muay Thai, I'm coming from boxing, because that's what I loved. And guess what? All those elements are in BKFC. We have single arm clinch. Hey, guess what? I'm living in Muay Thai, and now I can single arm clinch. We can be as rough as we want, shoulder barge, bro. That's some football skills right there. I love now that my full focus is BKFC, because it means that my training schedule is designed for that sport. It's completely different to how I was training when I was doing MMA, because MMA, you're still needing to juggle maybe your strengths or your weaknesses, S&C. Well, now everything is for BKFC. So it's predominantly a lot of boxing, so to say. And where I can put more focus on my body and strength and conditioning, combat strength and conditioning. I just think it's better. I think when you know your sport and what the goal is and what the focus is, it just means that you can refine the time that you have and making, like, the most perfect use out of it.
Yeah, and especially the kinds of people you've trained with in the past, you know, and right now. And does that give you a lot of confidence against, you know, facing this opponent who has only fought Muay Thai?
Of course, at the gym that I'm at right now, I've got some of the best girls in the game. I've got one of the number one to number two ranked Muay Thai girls of our size category. So now I'm fighting a Muay Thai girl who isn't on the rankings compared to Lena. Now, doesn't that even just that, those rounds in sparring alone should give you something. One, it gives you more of a Muay Thai look. It shows you the discipline of a female Muay Thai fighter. But two, I'm fighting a girl who's the number one to number two ranked in our weight division. So yep. Having girls where they're coming to Tiger, I had Italy's best boxer. I'm pretty sure she was a 140 pounder. And I'm getting sparring around a strict boxer as well as Veronica, who's Lithway and Muay Thai 115-pound champ. I've got, you know, like, I've got girls who are doing shit in this game. So that's the best confidence, to know that that's where you're kind of sitting, like, physically, athletically, and even as a fighter. That's the best way to walk into a fight. Like, that's the best way. Of course, I have to be realistic. She, Kunchai, has had over 80 Muay Thai fights. That's a lot of experience, mm-hmm. you know, but yeah, someone's strength is also their weakness. And that's like for everyone, even for myself.
Good. Let's go. Are you superstitious at all? Do you have any pre-fight superstitions you think that, you know, you have to do before getting in there?
Not really. Never have. Never in footy. I didn't have that in running. I never had that. And in fighting, I'm not going to have that either. Just because I don't want to ever get in that mind state that of thinking like that's what I need. And hey, for someone else that might work, but for me, like, okay, maybe one tradition: don't speak any fear around me or your negativity around me. I remember in the locker rooms, there'd be girls nearly crying because they were just like shitting bricks. And I remember I'd be like, and hold my breath and like walk away from them because I'm like, dude, I don't even want to breathe in that shit. Like, that's infectious. When someone has that much fear, like, you're going to infect the group. Get out of here. Like, fuck off with that shit. Like, exactly. And that's probably the only time when usually I'm really caring, but like, come game day, like, no, we get to, hell no, I ain't putting up with that. Like, this is my game day too. And we're going to give you some boosters to like feel good, but I'm not trying to breathe in other people's fears.
Yeah, it's the same in big productions I have. It's like when people bring that stress around, like, they got to go. Because that's when things got to start going wrong, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Things fall into place. Your tattoo game, lastly, before we get into fan questions. I feel like about a year ago, you didn't really have as many tattoos, right?
None.
What was your first one, and like, when did this addiction start?
Well, it's a new addiction, I believe.